Luigi brought Rosie home one morning when it was getting light. She invited him into the house for a hug and a little kiss goodnight. Luigi decided he'd propose and started to get on his knees. But he tripped and he and Rosie fell across the piano keys. The noise awoke Rosie's folks and Papa came down to investigate. He arrived and saw poor Rosie still pinned to the 88. Papa became suspicious of what the scene was all about. His face got red, he spluttered a bit and then began to shout, "Hey, please don't bang another piano. You're gonna wake up the whole neighborhood. Oh, please don't bang another piano. You promised your mama and me that you'd be good." When Papa was gone, Luigi got up to give Rose a helping hand. But he slipped again and back they fell across at the baby grand. Papa rushed back into the room and saw them where they fell. Then losing all of his self-control, he started in to yell, "What's the matter for you, Luigi? Don't you think it twice? Why do you bang in the piano? That's not very nice. If you gotta bang something, be nicer, girls and boys. Why don't you bang in the sofa way? You know, making no noise. Hey, please don't bang under the piano. Don't you ever stop to use your head. Hey, please don't bang under the piano." And with this, the old man went back up to bed. Rosie was serving coffee in Mama's favorite chinaware, but Luigi slipped and his coffee cup went sailing through the air. When it hit the piano, Papa jumped back out of bed. He ran back down to the living room and this is what he said, "It's not time and a place to bang, and you got no pride. Why don't you drive in the country and do your banging outside? First you bang in the piano, then you break your mama's cup. Luigi, you're so clumsy, you're gonna knock my Rosie down. Hey, please don't bang under the piano. You better be careful, Papa's getting sore. Hey, please don't bang under the piano. Luigi, you're gonna make my Rosie ashamed." Papa turned and bumped poor Rosie with an awful crash, and the coffee Rosie was holding hit the piano with a splash. Papa yelled him out on the kids, "Don't you learn yet? Three times you bang on the piano, and now you got it all wet. Hey, Rosie, Luigi, why you banging the piano?"
"Ma io non faccio lo bang sullo piano, io faccio lo bang sullo..."
"Hey, please don't bang under the piano." We do it with the television on. We do it until we're pale and wan. We never had so much fun in our lives. We even do it now with each other's wives. It's a wonderful indoor sport. It's a wonderful indoor sport. Just like they say on a rainy day, it's a wonderful indoor sport. We've done it so much that we are thinner now. We don't even stop to eat dinner now. But we'll have to give this playing up, because the men find it difficult staying up. It's a wonderful indoor sport. It's a wonderful indoor sport. When the girls are tight and their mood is right, it's a wonderful indoor sport. We did it one night until very late. We thought our wives we could educate. To our surprise, before the wives were through, they were using words we didn't know they knew. It's a wonderful indoor sport. It's a wonderful indoor sport. When the girls are hot, the men learn a lot. It's a wonderful indoor sport. We've done it in front of the fire too. We don't seem to lose the desire to. We do it in the morning when we wake up, just before we reach for the coffee cup. It's a wonderful indoor sport. It's a wonderful indoor sport. Both night and day we improve our play. It's a wonderful indoor sport. Last night we were doing it with Marie, who learned how to do it in gay Paris. The wives resent all the slang from her, but the men all get quite a bang from her. It's a wonderful indoor sport. It's a wonderful indoor sport. And we just haven't been the same since we got our Scrabble game. I'm a cocky cowboy, a cocky cowboy, conceited as can be. I'm a cocky cowboy, and all the gals agree, they just don't come any cockier than me. While riding in the rodeo way down in San Antone, I guess I showed them Texans that I could hold my own. I climbed a spooky filly when the crowd began to scoff, and I showed that bucking filly that she couldn't buck me off. I'm a cocky cowboy, a cocky cowboy, I'll never be forlorn. There are lots of gals who help me blow my horn, 'cause I've been cocky since the day that I was born. I've got the best equipment that a cowboy'd ever need. I got a big six-shooter and I got a trusty steed. All the cow gals love me, and the reason is, of course, I measure 6'8" and have a profile like my horse. I'm a cocky cowboy, a cocky cowboy, the star of each parade. Oh, I hate to see my youth begin to fade, but I guess I spend too much time getting drunk. There's one thing that I've got that I depend on like a pal, and every time I use it, I always get a gal. When I show them all my tricks, the ladies think it's grand. They always end up eating right out of my hand. I'm a cocky cowboy, a cocky cowboy, I'm the cow gal's pet. When the gals have seen it, they never do forget the way I use my trusty lariat. That's a rope, son. Oh, it's hanging by my saddle as ready as can be. It's hanging by my saddle clear down to my knee. And when it's all uncoiled, boy, you ought to see my stunts. In rodeos, I use it on 6 cowgals all at once. I'm a cocky cowboy, a cocky cowboy. I'm bragging how I thrive. If you gals will bet me, I'll lay you 10-5. I'll be a cocky cowboy as long as I'm alive. Down in old Savannah lived a fella named Joe. He used to run an eating place where ladies loved to go. Down in Savannah, Joe was known for miles and miles around, because old Joe had the biggest joint in town. Lucky old Joe had the biggest joint in town. Mothers brought their daughters in to sample Joe's dessert. The daughters just adored it, and they sampled till it hurt. One day a gal apologized for eating like a pig. That's fine, said Joe, that's what made the joint so big. Lucky old Joe had the biggest joint in town. Soon Joe was rich. He wore a diamond twice as big as a rock. But still old Joe wasn't satisfied with his life. He wanted to enlarge, so he began to advertise. He sent out picture postcards of his joint to show its size. His business got much bigger, but he didn't mind a bit. Said Joe, I'll just feed him any kind of food. Poor old Joe, his business started going down. Soon a kid named Sammy opened up across the street. What Sam was serving to the gals I wouldn't dare repeat. But pretty soon Joe's customers had moved to Sammy's place, because young Sam had a fascinating face. Poor old Joe had the longest face in town. Joe decided there was only one thing to be done. He stood in front of Sam's and questioned ladies one by one. And every gal he questioned would reply without a fuss, "You're all through, Joe, now it's Sammy's joint for us." Yes, young Sam has the nicest joint in town. Joe tried and tried to get his business back to its normal state, but his hands were tied and Sammy's joint was still doing great. Sammy's competition was a hard thing to defeat, 'cause kings and queens had recommended Sammy's joint to eat. But then one morning Sammy's voice had changed from low to high, because old Joe had cut off his food supply. And now old Joe, wise old Joe, lucky old Joe, still has the biggest joint in town. I've an uncle who's a queer one, and Daddy is his name, and his hair is blonde and always nicely curled. And though Addie wouldn't marry, he enjoys a certain fame, for he's got the smallest peacock in the world. Like I said, my Uncle Addie is a most peculiar bloke, and he's been peculiar since I don't know when. He will gladly show the ladies how to cook an artichoke, but he'll only show his peacock to the men. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, it's just about as small as one could get. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, still I've seen a cock or two that's smaller yet. Uncle Addie joined a circus and his peacock was a smash, and old Addie soon was rolling in the dough. But one morning he awoke to see his future start to crash, for the bloomin' peacock had begun to grow. Well, blimey, but it grew and grew just like a bloody weed, and 'twas quite a blow to see it get so fat. And it grew to such proportions and with such amazing speed, it was awfully hard to get it in its flat. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, it became enormous quicker than a wink. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, and then the blasted thing commenced to shrink. To be frank, it shrank much quicker than when it began to grow, till one morning there was hardly nothing left. Uncle Addie couldn't find it and was frantic, don't you know, he had Scotland Yard investigate the theft. Well, the good old yard cooperated thoroughly, of course, they dispatched their biggest dick with great dispatch. But it looked as though the peacock would evade the total force, and they thought it was the victim of a snatch. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, it was right where Addie left it after all. Oh, that peacock, oh, that peacock, he had overlooked it 'cause it was so small. Once he got it in his noggin that the peacock was a pain, Uncle Addie's course was drastic, it appears. For he went to Copenhagen and he gave it to a Dane, who'd been looking for one just like that for years. Heave to, my lads, while I relate how a pirate ship met an awful fate. Her plumbing was so antique that we must treat the subject delicately. The pirate chief had a brand new crew who'd been shanghaied from a raid or two. He lined them up all along the poop and made this speech to the motley group.
Do you know what the poop deck's for, my lads? Do you know what the poop deck's for? There ain't no head on ships like these, so the poop deck's used in emergency.
Yo-ho-ho, when you gotta go.
Sometimes on the poop it's a right tight squeeze. Imagine the captives' great chagrin when they saw the shape that the ship was in. In place of a modern plumbing job was a hole in the deck and an old corn cob. Well, the crew was true to the English code and refused to sail with no commode. They bullied the captain till he swore he'd steal the head from a man o' war. Do we know what the poop deck's for, my lads? Do we know what the poop deck's for? That's where we'll break the captain's neck if we get no head for this awful wreck.
Yo-ho-ho, when you gotta go.
He's dead if we get no head, by heck. They sailed at dawn on the 3rd of June and sighted a French man of war at noon. With nary a thought for the loot she bore, they pilfered the head of the man of war. The pirate crew made many a trip till the head was assembled aboard their ship. And the pirate chief, to complete the job, gifted the French with the old corn cob. Do you know what the corn cob's for, Cherie? Do you know what the corn cob's for? Well, the old corn cob in French perfume will have to replace your powder room.
Yo ho ho, when you gotta go.
No powder room, just French perfume. Well, the Frenchman yelled, "Mon Dieu, Alouette," all of which means we're not lick yet. So after the pirate ship, they ran with the battle cry of "Cherchez la canne." The Frenchman caught the pirate boat, but the pirates cut each Frenchman's throat. They rescued their commode and sink. Where else can a man sit alone and think? I hope this tale of the bounding main will help you savvy the pirate brain. You can take his knife or his wife or a sloop, but don't fool around with a pirate's poop. Fifi is a dancer in the French Folie Bergère. Her costume is transparent, you know the kind they wear. And so it's very easy to determine at a glance that Fifi's got the biggest one in France. There are many ways in which it serves our Fifi well, but it is one commodity that she will never sell. It's plain to see why Fifi uses it instead of banks. It can carry nearly 50 million francs. It's a large one, it's a large one. I'm sure it will go down in history. It's a large one, it's a large one. But Fifi claims it's snug as it can be. A Follies girl named Mimi said if hers were stretched a bit, she'd guarantee that four big men could all get into it. But Fifi got five men in hers, then murmured, "What a bore. I've still got room for half a dozen more." A mademoiselle from Gay Paris declared that with some luck, hers would be quite big enough to hold an army truck. But put it next to Fifi's and it wouldn't stand a chance, for Fifi's got the biggest one in France. It's a large one, it's a huge one, and of many jokes Fifi has been the brunt. It's a large one, oh a large one, but still Fifi has quite a charming front. Fifi went to America to give the Yanks a show. She even made the Texans forget the Alamo. A cowboy took her dancing and she got home rather late. Now she's got the biggest in the 48. Well, of course she went to Hollywood to make a movie test. The motion picture people were really quite impressed. For in the movie colony she made the biggest dent right at Hollywood and Vine in wet cement. It's a large one, it's a large one, and to be a movie star was Fifi's hope. It's a large one, it's a large one, it's the biggest thing they've done in CinemaScope. She took it back to France where it saw action in the war. She entertained more soldiers than any other girl. And though it is a secret that Fifi will not divulge, we know it won the Battle of the Bulge. Fifi was rewarded well for saving France's neck. They've allowed her to display it just below Toulouse-Lautrec. And though by now it's showing many years of wear and tear, it's the only two-way girdle that has ever won the Croix de Guerre. I sailed upon a ship away across the sea. I took a little trip to sunny Waikiki. The moment I arrived, I heard a lady say, "If this is Hawaii, why don't I get a lay?" Then I politely said, "Madam, pardon me. There's a custom here in sunny Waikiki. It may be rather hard for you to conceive, but you don't get a lay until the day you leave." A gleam was in her eye as coyly she replied, "I must admit that I enjoyed the ocean ride, but I have planned this trip since way last June, and if you get it when you leave, then I leave this afternoon." Not wishing to see her spoil her maiden trip, I said, "Please reconsider for a bit. If I can be of service, ma'am, to you, let me tell you exactly what I'll do. I'll take you to dance and to dine every night. I'll give you romance, sparkling wine every night. And to be sure that you don't shed a tear, I'll give you a lay every day while you're here." She said, "It sounds divine, quite all right with me. Romance and sparkling wine belong in Waikiki. It's nice of you to give a lonely gal a break, but a lay every day is more than I can take." A beach boy then began walking up the dock. He carried in his hand a giant orchid lay. The gal said, "There's a guy a girl appreciates. I'd never find a lay like that back in the States." So I took out a lay. I'd had it all the time. I heard the lady say, "I wish that it were mine. That's the longest lay for miles and miles around." Then she threw it round her neck, but it still hung to the ground. And then when her hips began to swing and sway, I knew I'd have to put the thing away. To give a gal a lay is simply grand, but nobody likes a dragon in the sand. I'd given her lay after lay for a week, and after a while I was too weak to speak. It wasn't the sunshine that took all my strength, it was trying to make the lays the proper length. When finally I returned back across the sea, my lady friend, I learned, remained in Waikiki. I'm sure she got a lay from each Hawaiian male, but I came away and thereby hangs a tale. I've never been a swimmer or a horseman of renown. I'm not a fancy fighter, couldn't win a boxing crown. But I am just adored by women short and tall, 'cause I'm the greatest broad jumper of them all. I couldn't run as fast as any other kid in school, and when I did a high dive, it would empty out the pool. But every gal I know is at my beck and call, 'cause I'm the greatest broad jumper of them all. Oh, what a jumper. And I don't mean maybe. Oh, what a jumper. I've been broad jumping since I was a baby.
I joined a nudist track meet, and when my turn came around, right from a standing start, I covered 30 feet of ground. I gathered from the way the ladies turned to stare, I was the greatest. One evening in a garden with another fella's wife, she said, my husband's coming, so start running for your life. She held him back while I went leaping through the air. I'm still the greatest broad jumper anywhere. Oh, what a jumper. I'm a real champion. Oh, what a jumper. All the gals can't believe what they are seeing. I've never been selected for an all-Olympic team, but in a broad jump contest I am always on the beam. And once I even won the title sitting down, 'cause I'm the greatest broad jumper that's around. I've done it for an audience, still I was stiff and sore. And when I'd had enough, the ladies always yelled for more. I finally decided it should be my trade. Now I'm the only broad jumper getting paid. Oh, what a jumper. I was young in starting. Oh, what a jumper. I can broad jump much farther when I'm sober. Today was my farewell performance over in the park. I had 100 women lying 40 feet apart. I started with the first and jumped them one by one. And now my broad jumping days are done. There ain't many men that are lucky enough to have one as long as mine. The thing is as old as I am, but still it is doing fine. Many's the time that I've been afraid 'twas going on the blink, but then upon closer scrutiny it proved to be in the pink. I've always treated it carefully and don't leave it lying about. Before I put it away I still remember to shake it out. And if I should ever be too weak to hold it in the air, I've instructed me wife to handle it with tender love and care. Oh, ain't it a beauty? And I have used it proudly all me life. Oh, ain't it a beauty? Now if you don't believe me, ask me wife. Danny O'Toole came calling one day to tell me that he had heard that mine was bigger than his was, and he didn't believe a word. I bet him a buck, then took him outside and laid it in the street. He couldn't believe it when he saw it was over 100 feet. One summer I happened to be out of work, and during me leisure hours I do a good turn by using it to water the neighbor's flowers. I met a young lass who needed it bad and used it for a week. Though it was abused for days on end, it never began to leak. I use it a lot in the summer, and I use it a lot in the fall. But I'm willing to bet in the springtime I use it the most of all. Oh, I've used it in December on a cold and wintry day, and I've written me name in a snowbank that was over a block away. Oh, ain't it a beauty? All the fellas envy my technique. Oh, ain't it a beauty? They hate me every time they take a peek. Though I must admit that it hasn't been used for 4 or 5 months or more, it's hanging there just as ready as it ever has been before. And you can be sure that I will still be using it for years, 'cause it's the finest length of garden hose they ever sold at Sears. Outside of Berlin, there's a house with a light. The light, it is red, and it's on every night. Along about midnight when our work is done, we head for that house on the run. Because they show such movies, ach, what movies, boy, what movies. Nice motion pictures about a romance imported directly from Paris, France. Oh boy, what movies. And they show them every night. If your girlfriend goes for unusual shows, try the house with a little red light. I'll never forget on one Monday in May, the house with the light had a big matinee. You couldn't bring ladies, not even your spouse, and word got around, it was all on the house. We went to the boards for the afternoon free. We told them what kind of a show it would be. We asked them to come with the rest of the bunch. He said, I'm with you, we get off after lunch. Oh boy, what movies. And our boss, he couldn't speak. Commencing that day, he doubled our pay, and we visit that house twice a week. There's movies of girls with their hair nicely curled, going on trips all around the world, on dances and poses that you've never seen, that never exposes, no space in between. While out for a beer with my neighbor named Joe, we decided our wives ought to take in the show. And we figured out if we sent them alone, the treat might improve things at home. They raved about those movies, ach, what movies, boy, what movies. They saw a police dog which was a beaut, and one Shetland pony which was so cute. Since they saw those movies, we've been treated like a prince. The nagging, it ceased, we men got our peace, and the peace has increased ever since. Oh, we men love our peace, so we bought up the lease on that house with a little red light. Hey, Mike, come in another drink. Mike, use your noodle. Don't ever get married. I had the biggest rhubarb with my wife tonight, and well, she's probably still yakking and throwing things. That Mary is the worst, no good, dirty... Oh, I'm terribly sorry, madam. I didn't notice you sitting there. Say, you look very familiar. Are you? What's that, Mike? Okay, I'll be good. Oh, that wife of mine. I dream of Mary, she's a real nightmare. And what do you think the beef was all about? Just because last night I went to a burlesque show. And you know what's bugging her? She don't know what time I got in. And I'm not sure I did. Hey, Mike, what a show. Boy, they got a stripper down there, it's great. And the comics are terrific. Listen to this. The little fella says, haven't we worked together before? And the big fella says, sure, back in Chicago when I was with a trio called Art, Bart, and Fargo. Say, Mike, did I ever tell you the story about the plastic surgeon that hung himself? And a big rope and no place to hang it. Oh, I'm terribly sorry, lady. Say, are you sure you're not familiar? You know, you must be getting loaded. Your face is all blurred. Have a drink. It'll sober you up. You know what? Listen, beautiful, I got a great idea. Let's you and me blow this dump and I'll show you my joint. You love it. Everybody loves it. What balls we have there. We'll have a little nightcap and we'll take a little look at the view, and then we'll... And I promise you the price is right. Well, how about it? I say, babe.
Don't you babe me, you stupid jerk. Just focus your bloodshot eyes on your wife, Mary. Yes, it's me, all right, your wife. I figured you'd be here, so I'm a nightmare, huh? And about that joint of yours, well, I'll fix that good. And this is the end of those balls, you no good ball.
Hey, Mike, just like I said, marriage is a wonderful institute. Marriage is a wonderful thing.